Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music. Good morning, everyone. I'm sax man Will Donato, cancer survivor, lover of life, and want to welcome you to today's special edition of Inside the Music with my pal Jack Cohen, music lover extraordinaire. And also joining us today in our gallery is beautiful Cheryl Aronson from the Hollywood 60, Hollywood 360. And today's show is what I call rarefied air, a very select group of premier vocalists that we admire on this show. Darryl F. Walker. F is fantastic, by the way. I looked it up. And also we have beautiful Ashling Biscuits Cole, and we have breaking news. She's switching to a low-carb nickname, Jack. She's leaving biscuits. She's going to almond, apple, or ginger. It's for 2018.
Wow, ginger.
She's dropping the lower-carb nickname.
That's so funny. I love how you put an S on there, biscuits.
Yeah.
Plural, more than one. Yeah. More than one. I'm not sure really how to take that. Okay.
So we have so much content in preparing for the show, which I always love preparing. These two artists are like getting a zip drive. The bio is only a zip drive. You open it up and each adventure unfolds to another credit and collaborative project. Today's very special guests are extremely talented, and I just want to thank you for...
And we like the hell out of these people.
Oh,
we really do.
This is real deal stuff.
We were having so much fun before the show.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, hopefully that'll translate during the show.
Absolutely.
Here.
And the key word of these vocalists, they're just so versatile. Everybody wants them in their projects. And when you're propelling a trajectory for your solo career and people are pulling you to, gee, could you come with me, Larry Graham, to join me? I guess so.
Oh, well.
So they're being pulled in wonderful directions by other A-listers.
Yes.
And when you got a trajectory to a solo career, you've got so many other opportunities along the way.
You know, and Will, speaking about trajectory, you've
I
been
can't spell it, but I can say it.
I can spell it, but I can't say it.
Can you spell pterodactyl? If you can do that, then we're in business.
Pterodactyl. No.
T-E-A-R-A.
Oh, I like that.
D-O-C-K.
Phonetics.
D-I-A-L. There it is.
Inside the spelling bee. So, Will, you've been in an upward trajectory yourself. It's been a couple weeks since our last show. I think it was like December 16th. And to remind everybody, we're the first and third Saturday of every month here on LA Talk Radio. Yes. So, Will, you played in San Diego at the Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club.
Loved it. Had a blast.
Place we need to get you two guys to play at.
You guys should do a collaborative there.
In San Diego. And
I
saw that show. That was an amazing show.
It was really fun.
Good.
We took the holiday show template, and we did not do any choral arrangements of Frosty the Snowman.
We did a house party.
We got
good.
All
well,
the
well, it's a good thing because Darryl already did that.
Choral arrangements? Oh.
We did a house party of funky Christmas tunes, and it was fun.
Awesome.
We called it a house party.
You guys tore it up.
It was fun.
People dancing in the aisles. Will was getting suffocated by women squeezing him tight in the audience while he was playing sax.
And that was before I went on stage.
I have to say this. All his shows are fun because what he does, and this is just me appreciating you, Will has a connection to the audience.
He does.
He appreciates each and everyone. He knows their names, and he appreciates all of them so much. And that love for the people that come out to see him, you could see it.
It goes right from him to them.
It comes back.
Oh,
I'm more entertained by him going to the audience. I don't even care.
Amazing.
I don't even care what he plays on saxophone. He could just breathe into it. And
that's a good night.
It's max entertainment. It really is.
No, it is.
Yeah, and then you went to San Antonio, did you not?
Went to San Antonio, and again, I'm hoping this is a guidebook to where you guys should be, because I would be more than honored to send you the direct contact. You probably might have played there already with East Bay Soul, but there's a wonderful place in San Antonio called the Big Bib.
Hmm. No, we haven't.
Oh, I we will should. Hook you guys up. Yeah, it's there's an entrepreneur who was voted Texas best entrepreneur for barbecue, and he loves funk and jazz.
Wow. Oh, wow. Whoa.
And
oh,
he,
that's who we need. We need them.
He's killer. He picks you up.
We're going tomorrow.
He picks you up at the airport, spoils you, creates an environment.
Well, what's his name? Well,
Stanley Shropshire.
Hmm.
And
can you spell that?
I'm surprised. Yeah.
S-H-R-O-P.
I'm not going to try that one.
Shropshire Pterodactyl. but it's a great venue, and we just had so much fun. It sort of is a deconstruction of the normal template for venues. It's just fun. And even he has a staff person walk around during the show with your CDs, making sure people buy the CDs.
That is amazing.
See?
What a great idea.
On the first show.
That's a smart man right there.
And it's just respectful.
It is.
And during the first show, while I was sharing with another artist, I did a package with another sax player that I enjoy. The gal that was doing the CD sales kept coming up to me while I'm just waiting to go on to my next, putting $20 bills in my pocket. I sold out of CDs on the first show because she was so aggressive about.
Yeah, well, nobody goes into the audience. I mean, it's great.
You know who I did see do that with was Sheila E. As the first person that I saw, and she had her assistant take the CDs, and during the show, she went like table to table.
Great.
Said, "Yo, she's in Oakland."
Great
and I was
business
brilliant.
Person.
Absolutely, because you forget. I've left at countless shows without somebody's CD in my hand, and then I'm at home like, well, I guess I got to download it. But there's something about that actually having a CD in your hand.
I think people love it, and then they might not even think about it. You know, like maybe during the break, somebody goes over to a table, and then nobody knows they're at the table. They're sitting there,
exactly.
Or they're going to the bathroom, talking to their friends. You know, ordering dessert. And, you know, people would love it if somebody came around.
Jeff Koshua, when I first got into smooth jazz, he told me, you know, Will, the most important thing at a concert, and I'm thinking, oh, ripping tins, you know, I'm ready for some advice. Meeting with the audience, engaging, just making sure you're putting your horn down and getting to the CD table after the show.
Right.
And I swear to God.
That can be a challenge.
The last note, I go right, I put my horn down, and I've watched other artists on package shows, they're like, were you good?
No, people are going to walk up.
I go right to the table.
Yeah, absolutely.
People are going to walk up, want a photo, you know, and before you know it, you know, a half hour is gone, and now half the crowd's gone, too.
Half the crowd's gone.
It's funny. I gave some advice for people that play Spagatini that asked me, well, what do you do? Well, first of all, I said, my shows are 90 minutes straight through. I don't take a break.
That's
I don't like to break the continuity.
I don't like to break. I don't either.
Like that. But when you finish, there's a side door at that stage.
Yeah.
You have to go out that door
and
to the front.
Absolutely.
You don't want to move through the room because you will be stopped.
So all you budding musicians out there, when you make it and you got a CD, use the back door,
Funny
get
advice.
Get
to the table. I mean, I've watched artists lose $200-$400 by just going, so how'd you start? Well, I fashioned a saxophone out of an old piece of bamboo. Oh, there you go. I get to the table. I heeded that advice. But anyway, long story. But the Big Bib, I highly recommend it. It's one of those magical nexuses where the music meets the right promotion,
that's very rare.
And Will, you had one more pre New Year's event in Tempe, correct?
I did what I think is one of my first theater shows, where I was exclusive billing, and I got to be honest with my peers here. I don't care how long we've all been in the business. There's something daunting about a hard ticket gig where this it's like Darryl Walker is going to be here in January. Not a built-in, or not even like as much as we love Spags. There's a small portion that still goes there on a date, and they just like jazz. But when it's a four-wall theater and your name is there and you want to do a good job, I'm just so
In layman terms, I think for the audience, what Will's saying is that he got booked in a venue where he doesn't go to Arizona that much.
Not that often.
In Tempe, he's the headliner. And so they're selling tickets based on his name. And for the event to be successful, the promoter has to sell a lot of tickets. And so that's pressure on Will.
Yeah.
And this
theater was
a performing arts center. But not huge, but gorgeous. You know, like with what they have. They had the booze.
Water. But what was really daunting is the promoter was a sweetheart. The show is December 29th. My booking agency is just still finalizing the contracts around December 3rd. And I'm so conscientious with social media and imaging and so forth.
Sure.
Like even Spags, I can't speak for myself, but I like a good 3 month lead, and I want to make sure.
Absolutely.
That's what I do.
Absolutely.
About 2 months.
And not only that, it's the 30th. Everybody is focused on New Year's Eve, so I'm thinking, give me one more variable to make this more difficult. But what's funny is the promoter's like, he wasn't even worried, and I'm thinking, you know, I'm the artist. I want to do a good job and put seats on the little squares, but mm-hmm. you know, it's like. December 5th, we finally signed the contract. I'm thinking, well, 29 minus 5.
How many days do I have to sell these tickets?
Because how many times have we gone on the Spagatini's website and go, wow, M1, that thing is still not moving.
How are you kidding me? That's the thing. You really become obsessed
with that chart.
Wait a minute. That's not great yet.
Again, to translate for our audience, the in Southern California, because I know we have people watch from all around the world, a renowned jazz club is Spagatini. And when you go to buy tickets, you go online and they show each table, and you can tell if the table's sold or not. So you know if you want to get invited back, you better see a lot of tables.
A lot of X's.
X'd out. Yes. So it's like nerve-wracking for an artist because they want to have continuity and be able to come back. And you can actually see each day how many tables were sold. So
I didn't want to bore my peers who I love dearly about a theater show, but I just still have that work ethic. I just want to do a good job for my promoter.
Of course.
I know sometimes some of our peers in the day when maybe smooth jazz, let's just say, was sloppier or more, what's the word? Just
free,
plentiful. That artists really didn't have to promote much. And
no,
now
it's a whole different day and age.
You
got to
roll
nowadays.
Up your sleeves.
Yeah.
There are some
really
friends
do.
That still, that's the promoter's job. I just can't do that, you guys.
No.
I just got to dig in a little bit.
The ones that realize.
At this point, it's a partnership. And
absolutely.
You know, it should be, too.
Absolutely.
It should be,
and
too.
Sometimes it's almost more of a goodwill effort. I will send an advance kit to somebody back east where I know the following is I'm not quite sure of my following there, but I'll send him an advance kit of some posters and table cards. He probably, like, I don't know where that stuff ends up, but it shows a commitment from me that I'm in it to win it.
That's right.
I don't know how impactful that is. Sometimes, I hate to say it, but you're in the show and you look in the little mud room on the way to the green room and you see your stuff still in the tube. Like, well, there it is.
All righty then.
Glad I spent $99 on four color processing.
Nice to know that all that beautiful stuff is still in the tube there.
Yeah,
right.
But I sent it. But anyway.
Yeah, exactly. No.
But anyway, the show was wonderful.
Reduce, recycle, reuse. That's what that is for. Yes.
But I really enjoyed the theater experience. And the first day I looked at the seating, there were bodies in this on the little chart. Mm. And it made my holiday. And I'm like,
yes.
Awesome.
Well, anyway, congratulations.
Thank
Will.
You.
Yeah,
because I hear that's going to lead to possibly some other things, too.
I already got rebooked to some other cities. And
beautiful.
Love it. But I'm hoping you guys can explore some of these other spots. I think East Bay, you alone at. And you know, I'm finding a lot of these cities now, you can go out and by yourself, and the caliber musicianship there is great. They are prepared. They're slamming.
That's good to know, because traveling with a band is really expensive.
Oh, yeah. And I'm finding so many great musicians on the road. And it's almost a new template. There's a cottage industry for them to do a great job. So Ashling will ask them back. I remember the old joke Ricky Lawson used to tell me, the worst sound you can hear as a leader is the sound of a FedEx package being unzipped.
An hour before your show
with your charts.
Right before.
Wow.
Like,
that's awful.
But anyway, thank you for asking about with the luminaries that we have here today. Thank you so much, Jack. I appreciate that.
You're welcome, Will. And so now let's move on to Ashling. Ashling, good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, you're looking bright and chipper this morning.
Thank you. I was up early. I had my coffee. You know, coffee's really important to me.
Yeah, that's a Will Donato thing, too.
Yes, coffee.
Yeah, Will calls it zero dark 30 when we get up to.
That's right.
Yeah, because I came from San Diego, which is 2 hours up and 4 hours back.
Yeah,
and,
yes, exactly.
Yeah, and Darryl came from basically San Diego, too. And
you came
from
Temecula.
Temecula,
so
yeah.
It's about 90 mm-hmm. minutes. They closed yeah. the 91 this morning, which was really
oh.
shocking.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, that
happens.
Don't you love it when stuff like that happens?
Yeah, I do. Luckily, I was going to be here early anyway, so I got here, I guess, on time. It's all good.
So I have had a blast researching both of you guys, and it's just I have this new hobby of looking at our peers' bios because there was a trend where we had to write a bio, but then we also had to put our credits. Larry Graham, Sheila E. Prince. So here's how bios read. At six, I had an affinity for singing, and then now I'm on stage with Larry Graham.
That's exactly right.
They all
that's
read
exactly
like that.
Right.
There's something missing
that's
in
exactly
this bio.
Right. That's exactly right.
And that's why we have Inside the Music.
That's
with
why
Will
we have Inside.
Jack,
but I love it. Right. But the study of the bios now. At two, I was singing along with Ed Sullivan, and I'll be at Spaghettini's with Greg Adams. Something was missing there. So this lovely lady, at six, you knew this is what you wanted to do.
Yes, I did. I did.
Now, I have a question. Were your folks musical? Or
So my mother came from a family of seven, and she was one of five girls. And my family name is Jackson. So they were the original Jackson Five. They used to laugh about that. But they grew up in impoverished Dublin, Ireland. Mm-hmm. And had zero opportunities. There were opportunities to, you know, to barely eat dinner. That was basically how they grew up. My mother was a trailblazer, and she left Dublin when she was 17 and moved to Paris. She was a model in Paris, and she always loved music, and she was always really deep in the music community. So growing up, we always had records, and blues is really like where my heart lives, which of course then immediately goes over to gospel music. I wasn't raised in the church or like really listened to gospel music. I played catch up later on in life. But man, blues is just because it's about storytelling. And I don't call myself a singer. I really am a storyteller. And I think that everything that we go through is great. You know, we're talking about that. You know, writing about your experiences, and that I know pain, I know love, I know loss, I know pain, I know joy, I know about gratitude, I know about success and failure and all that stuff. So why not put it in a song so maybe someone else can be encouraged going through the same thing, or avoid that dark alley because I went down it already, you know? So, right. So it's really
isn't that what art is, though? That's that beautiful form of communication.
Sure.
Where you give part of yourself,
yeah,
and hopefully people recognize it, right?
Sure,
yeah,
absolutely. And I think that goes along with really being honest as a singer, because I think that you can sing really well and just have it be very surface. There are technicians. Mm-hmm. There are people that sing that I call technicians, and they are phenomenal. There's not a note miss. There's not a nothing. But maybe I don't feel it. And like for me, I really want to feel it. I really want to like feel somebody's passion.
Yeah, I think when audiences go, they want to feel it too.
Yeah. Sure.
They really do. They want to
really
connect.
They don't
with
want
the artist
someone phoning it in.
No, yeah. They do not. They yeah.
They're giving of their time and resources. So
absolutely.
Why would they want to sit?
I'll take a bunch of missed notes and great passion and emotion over a perfect
absolutely.
Performance every time.
Well, absolutely. We were talking about your range, you go from delicate to badass with Larry Graham. We got delicate and badass. And you know that's true.
You know what? I was telling Will on the way up because I've seen you many, many times. And
yes.
I go, you have to. Ashley's such a sweet, nice person. You see her on stage. She is a badass.
No, wait. That's what happened. That's what happened when I first was exposed to her.
I love that.
We're doing a show with Rebecca Jade at Spaghettini, yes. and she came in and was in the audience, and Rebecca called her up. And she's all sweet and demure coming up on the stage, and all of a sudden, wah!
I love that.
Dang.
Oh my goodness.
So,
wow. That's fighting.
Okay, I have a question. So I'm still fascinated. So 6 years old with this beautiful family and the blues records. So you're informed that you want to go to the San Francisco Girls Chorus.
Yeah, there was an ad in the paper. So my dad.
Now, how
my
does
dad,
a six-year-old find that? How do you know that?
Right. So my. So I was going to tell you, my dad and I every Sunday morning we read the Sunday comics. My dad read the paper every single day. San Francisco Chronicle did not miss a beat. Sunday morning, that was our time to read the comics, and it was like my favorite. You know, my favorite time with my dad. And so flipping through the newspaper, there was an ad for San Francisco Girls Chorus, and I read it, and I thought, yeah, Dad, that's what I want to do. And my like without missing a beat, my dad just he was not musical. Sweet. My dad could not don't even sing me Happy Birthday on my birthday. He's like, please don't. But my mom had a beautiful voice, and it was definitely passed down to me. And I just had amazing opportunities more so than I think my mom had. But it was very expensive.
Did your mom sing professionally?
She never did.
Oh, she never did. Yeah.
She was a writer. She was a phenomenal writer.
Was a stunning, yes. Stunningly looking person too.
Yeah.
She was in my son's book. We met her on the Dave Cause cruise, and we didn't know she was your mom at the time, right? And we looked at her. Man, look at that woman. She'd be great for Ari's book. Beautiful woman. Very beautiful woman.
Yeah. She passed away 2 years ago, and she came with me on the Dave Cause cruise. And people used to wait outside our cabin, to see what she'd have on. Oh. She was like that woman. She just was.
You know, I was telling Will on the way up, your mom was sick at the time, right?
Yeah.
So I still remember this, and I think about it periodically. You on that cruise, you were cradling your mom in your arms.
Yeah.
And it was like you knew that you didn't have all the time in the world, and you just wanted to enjoy every minute with you could. And that was so touching.
Yeah.
That was so touching.
In the end, what it's really all about.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It was beautiful. I mean, I can't even. And then you called in our show when your mom was sick, too.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we had about a half hour. And that was. That was the highlight of all the shows that we've had.
Well, what was amazing is the last year, the last 2 years of her life, I've been in the background, you know, my whole career. I did start, you know, San Francisco Girls Chorus studying opera and doing all the classical stuff, which was just amazing foundational training. So I read music, I can conduct an orchestra. I have like all these amazing tools in my storage unit, my wheelhouse.
That's the new one, yeah. Wheelhouse.
Yeah, that's the new.
Yeah, in my storage unit. So my mom, in her dying process, was like, "You need to go do your own stuff." And I've been writing songs for my whole career because it was sort of therapy for me. It was never for writing for other people or other people's, interest.
That's the best stuff, though.
Yeah.
Because it comes from a place of absolute soul connection.
Absolutely.
Right. When you're with one with yourself,
yeah.
That's your best work.
Absolutely.
You're going to produce totally your best work.
Yeah, so then she just really encouraged me to do my own record, which is how the, Where Love Began.
Well, the chorus, San Francisco Chorus, then you started doing theater, Academy of Media and Theater, and you also did the American Conservatory Theater.
Yeah.
So now, are we seven now? Are we nine?
I did San Francisco Girls Chorus for six years.
So now you're
so
12.
I'm 12.
And then you joined Larry Graham at 13.
Yes.
I'm going to figure
it. And I'm 19 years old
okay.
now. Yes.
So now
yes,
what are you doing? Are you singing? Are you starting to sing a little bit with R&B band at 16?
So the first R&B records that really piqued my interest were like Michael Jackson's Thriller, Whitney Houston's first album. I remember when Mariah Carey's Vision of Love first came on the radio, and I was in the living room, and the radio, like we had the big stereo with speakers everywhere, and I just stopped in my tracks. Vision of Love came on, and I was like, this is the voice of an angel. And I was completely inspired. I was signed to Interscope Records
with
when
John
I was
McClain.
Yeah, when I was 16 and a half, going on 17.
So are we now in the 90s-ish?
Sure.
Oh.
I was supposed to ask these questions. What not to ask? Here, no.
So, okay.
No, it was...
Because there was a nice boom around 90.
It was about 90.
Like late 80s?
Yeah.
Because I was actually running around the 80s with MCA on a band called The Untouchables. It was a ska band.
Wow.
And we were kind of courted by Interscope, and
nice.
We were with Twist
Records.
Yeah, no,
92 was...
That was a happening scene for Interscope.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because No Doubt was
sure.
hanging out there.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
There was a lot of action there. Did you, were you approached by them to be sort of a amazing hired gun for other acts, or were they looking for you to be a solo artist?
No, I was with a girls group, I was signed as a group. We were produced by Derek Hall, who's from Oakland, California, which I'm a Bay Area girl, San Francisco, Oakland. And so I was signed as a group. Excuse me. And then that went nowhere. That went nowhere. I actually came back from that in like 94 and quit music altogether.
What was the name of that group? Just out of curiosity.
It wouldn't matter. It wouldn't matter because we were never released.
Is that how you met Bobby McCall?
Bobby McCall, wow. No, he was before that. I was like 14. He was management. He was father of Money B from Digital Underground.
Digital Underground.
Yeah. Okay. And so I was hanging with those guys. I'm in one of their music videos, which is really funny, on a bus. I think like No Nose Job or something like that. I think I'm like in my mall hip hop. I was a hip hop dancer and I was with a rap group. Oh, that might, look, we'll be here all day.
No, is there, because YouTube has some surprises out there.
Sure.
Are there any archives of that out there?
That video, yeah, Digital Underground video is for
sure. If I would have known that well, that would be happening right now.
So glad.
I'm still trying to get a beat on your amazing trajectory because you guys are so versatile. It just blows me away that you guys can even go forward without people going, I need you. I need you. So now you're coming home, 92. 94.
I quit music. I started waiting tables. No. I quit music. Oh, yeah, no. Mm-mm.
Not even doing corporate work?
No.
Singing with
a
local?
No. So I got a job.
And you were in San Francisco, though, now.
I was in Oakland.
Okay.
I started waiting tables at a place that had karaoke night. I didn't know that they had karaoke night when I first, it was called Christie's Bar and Grill in Emeryville, California. They're no longer there, but it was right next to Kimball's East that used to be also in Emeryville. And one night, the guy that was hosting karaoke didn't show up, and they needed somebody to do it. And so I stepped in, and I went up, and I sang, and people were completely shocked. In fact, I couldn't get anybody else to come up on stage to sing karaoke. I had to sing all night.
The best kept secret at Christie's Bar. The best kept secret.
Ash, you didn't sing Sweet Caroline, did you?
No, I didn't.
Excuse me, miss. Could I get my patty melt?
Hey, what happened to my? Where's my coffee? Where's my coffee?
That's so funny. Yeah, I wasn't into coffee back then.
So now,
And so a group called Christian came into Christie's Bar and Grill. They heard me sing and they hired me to sing on their record. And then that led to some other studio work. And then that led to corporate work with Larry Batiste and Claytoven Richardson. And
415 is later in life.
And the 415s were later. This was a group called Encore. And
did you enjoy those? Did you enjoy just so there's, I need you to sing this, and this?
Corporate was really hard for me. I had to carry, I mean, this was before the iPad, right? So I had to carry a music book, like, yay, big. And like lyrics. And I, right, kill me now. So my worst nightmare gig was a gig that I was hired to do, and it was a combination of cover tunes and original stuff, and I had all my sheets out, and I had everything in my book, and I show up to the gig, and the guy says, you can't have that on stage. And it was my worst nightmare gig. And it was a valuable lesson, though, because I never did that again. I never, ever, ever showed up to a gig unprepared and not knowing what it was that I was doing. And so, of course, now the iPad, sure, I'll have it. You'll see me with certain gigs. I'll have it as a reference. But I don't like to depend on it. And it also gives me the freedom to improvise. And so if I do forget a word or something like that, so what?
Yeah,
you know, exactly. Spaghetti and meatballs. Like, you can say anything in a song. And really, and it's enjoyable to the audience. As long as you're committed, right? You got to be committed to it.
You know, so many times I've been to Spaghettini and maybe I, like, filmed a song that somebody did on my phone, right?
Yeah.
And then the artist come up to me after, don't post that. I go, well, why? And then they go, well, I hit a wrong note at blah, blah, blah. And meanwhile, they got a standing ovation from the audience.
I know. Because we're so critical. We're the most critical on ourselves. We are the most critical.
It's neurotic, actually.
Absolutely.
You know, you guys are such a gift to those corporate bands because you're just real. Real deal, real phrasing, real intonation. And I just can see you guys like just carrying these books of, you know. We need some Bill Withers, Darryl. All right.
Right.
All right, no problem.
All right, lovely day. Here we go.
Here we go. Done.
And you know now what I do. In fact, I'm going to shout out Tracy Carter. And I don't know if he's listening or tuned in or anything, but I had him come down to Temecula to do this little place called Gourmet Italia. And
I know it well.
Last month, do you?
I do, and it's great food.
Such a great place.
Yeah, before Thornton Winery, a lot of times we go to eat there.
So such good food. They have their own wine. They like ship in ingredients for their stuff from Italy. It's just
phenomenal,
amazing place.
Phenomenal place.
Yeah. Alex, the owner, is amazing. But Tracy Carter came down to do a Christmas holiday show, and we just made up stuff on the spot, and it was so great because when you're working with someone that's at that level of musicality. And has big old ears.
And a great singer himself.
Mm-hmm. And we just took all kinds of liberties.
That must be improv city.
That's fun.
You'll never hear it like that again, right?
Yeah, you would never.
So that's the cool part about it.
And for our audience, Tracy Carter, he was a musical director for Gerald Albright, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, and sometimes the Dave Cosgrews. Mm-hmm. And toured with everyone in the smooth jazz industry,
Absolutely. Pretty
much. A phenomenal singer on his own.
Yeah, excuse me.
Well, that's what attracts me to you two guys. There's a humility, but I still have this adage. Sometimes there's certain musicians, I call them parties in a can. You could put a Darryl Walker right now, drop him in Philadelphia.
A party in a can.
A guy needs a entertainment for 3 hours. This guy will find a sax player and a drummer if
it's
he doesn't
like
bring his
the,
own sax.
The snakes,
and entertainment
right?
will go down.
Oh, it will happen.
It will happen.
It will happen.
That's so
you
funny.
Have to be like you
I'm
said,
serious. It's a party. You are nucleuses of a lot of universes. I mean, I'm being respectful because when you're a saxophone player, I love playing saxophone, but I'm also conscious sax verse, sax bridge, sax melody, sax solo. Hold on a second. I have vocal choruses built into my songs, and I don't even sing. The audience sings.
Nice.
So when guys like myself or Blake Aarons call you, it is something that we are cognizant of that we need to connect in the overall arc of a show.
Absolutely.
Very few people can sit there all night and go, you know.
No, it's true.
And I say that respectfully.
No, it's true.
Sure.
It's a thing that, you know, most people's attention span isn't that great, especially with life today moving as fast as it does. You go into a setting where you're listening to an instrumentalist, as phenomenal as they might be, people tend to lose interest, and I don't know what that is, but something about a voice gets them.
Oh, yeah, for
and
sure.
And it just, yeah. they just...
I feel that connect. Way about tracks, too. Like, I have an adage as a horn player, once you go vocal, you can't go back. Once you go track, you can't go back. Because like... So I always lead my... I don't use tracks in my live show.
Mm-hmm.
I use tracks with artist sax all the time, but, you know, I see artists, like, doing tracks, doing live tracks.
Yeah.
You better make sure you're cognizant of where you're going with the flow. But
that's a tough mm-hmm. transition.
So yeah. I have a question just off the record.
Yes, but we're on the record.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. Off the record on
just
all these.
Between
on
us.
The air.
Just between us.
Well, do you want me to mute the mics here?
Okay, Jack's muting the mics. You know
Ask
what?
Away. Yes.
The mics are muted. We have the most amazing audience that watches this show. Don't worry, the mics are off.
That's so funny.
And they're going to go to your websites and they're going to buy product. Go ahead, turn the mics back on.
There you go.
So anyway, I loved hearing the influences in your voices, and I heard a lot of influences. Like with Darryl, I hear Giroux, I hear Hathaway, I even hear Bobby Caldwell some intonation.
You keep going.
No, but I hear
he's dead on. But there's so many.
Otis Redding, but
Stevie Wonder, Peebo Bryson.
But I hear and how beautiful that is that you guys. And I don't mean it dismissive at all, but because you guys are signature artists, you've arrived. I know your voices when I hear them now. I mean, I really do. But
awesome.
So tell me, in your car right now, or your iPod, what are you listening to right now? Even if it's a guilty pleasure.
That's so funny. It's so funny that I mentioned Mariah Carey, Vision of Love, because I listened to that entire album yesterday in my car. The entire album from beginning to end. And it was just like, for nostalgic purposes, I just, I don't know,
it's
it just
quality.
Takes me back. It's such
it's
good.
Walter Afanasieff is what it is.
It is. I can't quality. Spell his
Ashling,
name either.
Didn't she write most of her hits or co-wrote with somebody?
With Walter, right?
In the early days, the first two records, yeah, she and he they did a great thing together. I don't know why that synergy was ever broken, but that was the signature synergy for her.
Because I don't know how many number one hits there were. I mean, that's great songwriting.
Almost every song on that album.
Because people don't think about Mariah Carey as a songwriter, but she co-wrote, right?
Well, it's the production. That Walter Afanasy was one of those guys that just, from arranging to actual production, he knows all of it, and he's so good at all of that.
So speaking of songwriting, Ash, now you have a EP out called Where Love Began, correct?
Yes, correct.
Which I've heard many of the songs. I've heard you perform a lot. Love it. Love
Thank
everything
you.
About it.
That's great.
And what's your songwriting process? And I hear you have a surprise for us about that songwriting process. Would you?
Oh, the songwriting process for me can start, it always starts with something personal. If it's not something personal, it's something I heard or something I aspire to be. Like, there's a song on the album called Let's Pretend, and it's a made up story. It's about, you know, which, I'm not even going to tell on myself, but anyway, that is a made up story. The microphone is on, about, you know, just finding sort of whimsical love that just, you know, starts and ends, and let's just pretend that we're in love, and, you know, something like that. And
what a great concept.
I mean, it's a great concept. And then, you know, Where Love Began is about, in my mind, a married couple that somehow, like, wants to stay together and has all the goods to stay together, and they've just sort of lost their way, and how they communicate back to that point of, let's get back to where love began. Now, when I sing that song, Where Love Began is with me and my, you know, my relationship with God and you know, with the earth and you know, all of that stuff. So that's when I sing it, that's the place that I'm coming from, because I haven't had a successful marriage yet. Amen, somebody.
testimony.
Any candidates, call LA Talk Radio and leave a message, and we'll call you back.
Can I quote that? I haven't had a no.
Can I share an anecdote about both of you guys? So I noticed you both share something in common. You both have power-packed EPs. So I was going to first give a peer loving, respectful, why'd you guys do EPs? Why don't you do four more songs and you got an album for your grown folks? I factored in how busy you guys are.
Right there, yeah.
I factored in how busy you guys are. So I thought, okay, cool. And then I listened to the EPs cover to cover. They were so satisfying. I don't think I can handle 9 songs.
Wow.
Seriously, because, you know, some EPs are a little emaciated. Your EPs are like,
well, you know what?
They're so satisying. I'm serious. I got goosebumps. Your EPs, I don't know if the world is ready for 10 songs from you guys. You're so damn good. But they're satisfying.
Well, you know, Will, every song is good because you're not trying to, oh, I'm at 9. How do I get to 10? Yeah. You're not writing it from the place that you wrote from.
They're satisfying.
Where you have an idea of feeling.
They're great.
So yours is genuine because you're not trying to fill out 10 songs. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what's interesting in that, you know, I only have one record. I did a record years ago where Gerald Albright played on it, and it was a really great project. I don't call it my first album because I was a hired gun to come in and record these songs, right? So, you know, Where Love Began is what I call my first album or my first EP. It was put together as a it's a story from beginning to end. So when you start, it's, you know, it talks about let's pretend we're in love. Then it talks about, like, actually meeting someone that you fall in love with. Then it talks about heartbreak, and then it talks about how you get back to self and center.
I love that.
You know, it's just it's
it has
fluid.
An arc, and it's got a purpose.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I have a song here that you're going to tell us how you wrote it, called Let's Pretend.
Yeah.
And so I have the a cappella version.
Absolutely.
Well, that's what you labeled it. So we'll play that first.
Yeah,
you
know, can I set it up?
Let's reset to the listeners. We're going to do something very cool here. It's never been done before on the show, and I think it's cool. You've got a recording artist that's going to talk you through the process of basically what we would do on the road, maybe demo something, and she's going to talk you through the whole process from beginning, inception to end, and where we create ideas sometimes will probably surprise a lot of listeners. How many times have we called our Well, I'm not going to spoil the story, but basically this lovely artist is going to talk you through the process of what a lot of us go through from inception, originating an idea, to completion. So I think this is so cool. We've never had this before.
Absolutely. I'm excited to share this process as well. Now, I have a Mac and I use GarageBand, and I don't play. I have not been gifted to play. I mean, I played saxophone in school and blah, 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 and I can find my way around a piano, but I'm not gifted, and I stay out of that lane because there's so many gifted people that do that.
Ladies and gentlemen, Biscuits Elliot. There's enough of us around. Please don't take up the sax. There's not enough real estate left.
No, I'm not going to.
Darryl?
I was a good saxophone, but I was first chair. I have to tell you, I was first chair. Anyhow, so what I decided to do instead of waiting for other musicians because people are so busy is I just got in GarageBand and I sang down every single part. So what you're going to hear on this particular recording, and I'm really excited to play this for you and then play the album version so you can see the metamorphosis. But I'm singing bass. I do vocal percussion. I am singing the horn lines. I am doing the lead and the backgrounds and everything. And this was my first attempt at doing a whole entire song, and then I sing with an a cappella band, and so we're actually going to put this on our album that we're working on
cool.
this year, and that band is called Sovoso, S-O-V-O-S-O. You can look it up online. It means from the soul to the voice to the song, but go ahead and play this. So this is Let's Pretend, the original GarageBand vocal recording.
So this is the before at before.
This is before, yes.
Before Dexatrim. Before
before my amazing
before
band
Slim
got their
Fast.
Hands on
before
it.
Before Slim Fast.
Yes.
Here we go. Let's pretend.
The moon and stars are in your eyes. Don't wanna let you go tonight. Hold me till morning brings a light. And these may breathless, pretending that you're mine. That this feeling is forever. This life is only temporary, 'cause you're not mine, you're not mine. Your timing is impeccable. My cup was empty, now it's full. You've got me breaking every rule. I feel so reckless, pretending that you're mine.
That's your first attempt?
That was my first attempt. So, I mean, yeah.
Wow.
So, I mean, we're just fading it out because I wanted to just give people an idea.
We charge an hour to do that.
That's so funny.
Not
but
enough.
It was so much fun. It was so much fun, like, trusting myself in that process.
Now, you played all the parts there, right?
I sang all the parts.
Wow.
There's not one instrument on that track. It
yeah,
is
that,
all
that was phenomenal.
That is great.
It's all
That's
vocal.
Called connection.
Connection.
Yeah.
It's called... desperation is really what it's called. It's called desperation because I didn't have anybody else to do the stuff, and I was determined. I was like, I have this song in me, and I'm gonna die if I don't record it.
And
if I don't get it out of
me, that's why you did
me,
it.
Yeah,
because there was no one. You had
absolutely.
To. You were on fire. You were on the mat.
Absolutely.
The fire was lit. You were on the mat. Okay, I got to do something.
I got to do it.
Let's do it.
And so, if
awesome.
I think we're gonna now play the album
we
version.
Are. Yeah.
So
yeah.
I took that. And I brought it to the band. The band that played on my record is a Bay Area band. It's Darryl Anders and Aaron
Agape
Green,
Soul.
Agape Soul, and Cam Parridge, and there's a bunch of people. I don't know about this particular song, but Lynette Williams also played on the record, and Mike Blankenship, and Adam Thies, and there's just a ton of Bay Area folks on this. So this is what the song then became.
Yeah, this is how the song evolved and what it evolved into. Here
yeah.
we go.
Ooh. Like a snare. Snares.
Mm-hmm.
that is a great cut. So that was the before and after. Holy. Can we hear some more before and afters?
Wow.
You'll have to have me back because I have plenty of them. I have plenty of them.
It's like a Guthrie Renker fitness program with a lime green band.
It comes with a, it's the Ashley
but
Cole
wait, there's more.
Workout.
Oh, back now.
We have a lime green band for more tension.
Before we run out of time, how did you hook up with Larry Graham? How'd that happen?
Wow. So in Oakland, I had been doing corporate gigs with Wilton Rabb, who's the one of the original guitar players for Graham Central Station. And he...
Maybe for our audience, we should explain what Graham Central and Larry Graham is.
So Larry Graham, he was the original bass player from Sly and the Family Stone. And he went on to start another band where Chocolate was the lead singer. And then they did their first show and people were like, no, Larry Graham, Larry Graham, we want Larry Graham. So Larry Graham came up and then it became Graham Central Station. So he was never going to be a lead singer or the front man or anything like that. But so that's how that happened. And that was like early 70s.
What a phenomenal front man he is.
Oh, my goodness. One of the best.
Yeah. And from the costumes to talk about relating to the audience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So
one of the best.
If you've never seen a Larry Graham show, you have to see it.
Must.
So exciting.
Must see. And he is, you know, he's in, you know, 70, you know, wherever he is in his age. Pushing 70,
you'd
never
know.
We're trying to keep up with him. We're literally on stage trying to keep up with him. And he's jumping and running and, you know,
amazing
all the rest
costumes.
Of it. It's amazing. And one of the nicest people you ever meet. Really, one of the nicest people.
You have such a presence on that show. I just can't I can't explain. Now, do you play an electronic percussion instrument?
I play a drum pad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I play. Yeah. It was called the Funk Box.
Yeah.
So originally, the Funk Box was played with your hands. It was a strip, you know, digital, and it would be pre-programmed, and Chocolate, the original singer from Graham Central Station, would play it with her hands. So then they don't make those anymore. So the new version was an SP 404 or something like that, and that was like.
So you inherited that role. It wasn't like you.
Oh
said,
yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Do you enjoy it?
I love it. It's I love fun. It. I try so to every now and then I incorporate it into my own show. But it's so fun. And then getting to tour with Sheila E. And Ooh. Then watching the master. Right. She is the master percussionist and drummer.
Sure.
And so I try. I'll never ever be as good as her. But.
Do anything with her? Or
No. I would never embarrass myself. Never embarrass myself. Like I said, I'll stay in my lane. stay in my lane. I'm owning that lane.
You know what? What great
another
colloquialism.
Wheelhouse.
What a great performance.
The best. Yeah. I feel so incredibly blessed and privileged to have toured
and
with these.
And believe me,
amazing.
Having you by their side is
thanks,
it
Jack.
Enhances
I appreciate
the
that.
Show. I mean, I have some great photos of you doing something. You raised the drumstick over your head, and it's pretty amazing.
Well, and what was interesting is I had been with Larry Graham for a couple years and then met Prince. And Prince was really he was the person that really came in and just shifted my thinking to really believe in myself more so than anyone else. I mean, I used to stand behind the drum pad with Larry Graham, and he would, like, he'd have to coax me to the front, like, really, because I've been in the background, right? I was comfortable back there. And he was the one that really, you know, Larry Graham really started me doing on I Can't Stand the Rain and
you
really
gotta hear
owning
her
the stage.
I Can't Stand the Rain is just... oh my God.
But it was Prince. It was Prince that said that they're really, he called me out to lead his band. We were doing an after party and I was on the back, you know, I was on the sides of the stage like, oh my goodness, Prince. And he looked at me and called me out and I looked behind me. I was like,
Why was that?
Why?
Yeah.
Because I was there because he was a fan.
Oh, really?
He'd seen me with Larry. We had been touring.
Oh,
and
okay.
He was a fan of my voice.
What an honor.
And oh my goodness. And then I was like, once Prince co-signs on you.
Oh.
Yeah, you're good
to
go.
Yeah, you can't.
What
good.
Else is there?
I'm good.
Yeah.
What else
That's
is there?
That's Geico on steroids.
Man. Yeah, I mean.
So now we are running out of time.
Yes.
You guys are so content rich. The time is flying. I want you to tell the listeners just about how we can do business with you, where we can find you, what do you have coming up, or even just projects that you're looking to do. Your website, just
so my summer website is ashlingcole.com and it's ashling Not Ashley, but Ashling. And so you can find a bunch of information there. I have a new single called The Other Side of Yes. I sort of mentioned early on today about gospel music. It's like I love singing gospel music. So I'm doing a series of inspirational sort of CCM, contemporary gospel songs.
You're so great for that too.
Thank you.
Do the Praise Fellowship Bible Church.
They're actually in Northern California, and I was the worship leader there. I'm happily, gratefully looking to be a worship leader somewhere in the San Diego, Temecula area if anyone needs somebody. But The Other Side of Yes is a single that's out right now. I have a second.
We got to pay at least 2 minutes of that. So okay if I play some
of
it?
Absolutely, please.
Yeah, why don't you set that up? Because I love the song.
Please, thank you. This is called The Other Side of Yes. It came, again, from songwriting for myself, just working out, traveling all over the world and seeing that people are the same. We're the same. We all want to be loved. We all want to be successful. We all want to be accepted. And when we say yes to all the good things that life has in store for us, it just changes our existence. So this is about what happens on the other side of yes.
So we're going to play this tune, not in its entirety, and then Ashling's going to come back and play live for us.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
So here we go.
Great.
On my heart today to write a song for the broken. Seen so many shattered lives and so many lonely hearts were broken. They say, where do we go? Who can we turn to now? When all that we've known and all that we've trusted is gone. Well, I'm here to tell you there's hope. Here to remind you there's happiness and joy. It's on the other side of yes. It was on my heart today to write a song for the hope.
Write a song for the hope, yes.
Ones who lost and given up have no more fighting than the hopeless. They say, I say yes, oh yes, oh yes. I say yes to you.
That's perfect production. And who mixed that?
So this is produced by Jan Hunter, who's up in the Sacramento area, and Marcus Phillips on bass, Cam Parrish on guitar. And Jan played everything else. He did drums and keys and everything. I have to give a special, special shout out to Sarah Williams, who arranged, wrote, and sang down those background vocals. And that's what she does. She's out. Wow. Actually, she sings backgrounds for Lettucey. She's on this Grammy-nominated album, and she is phenomenal. That's what she does. If you need backgrounds, call Sarah Williams. Her social media is Sangin Sarah, S-A-N-G-I-N-S-A-R-A.
She's got a panel van with a graphic.
No, seriously.
Graphic rap.
She's phenomenal. She's phenomenal.
Now, you did something with our friend Darryl Williams, Don't Ask the Neighbors, or Don't Ask My Neighbors.
Yeah, Don't Ask My Neighbors.
I love that song.
I did. It was so great. It was the last song that he did on his album, and he asked me to come over. We did it at his house, and it was, yeah, such a great
shout out to Darryl Williams.
Oh, yes, my buddy, my Temecula buddy.
He's amazing.
He's so great.
Yeah, I mean, the community work, mentoring kids to come and jam.
Absolutely.
Sideman to the stars.
Absolutely.
Husband.
Yeah.
And good friend.
And good father. Don't forget father. Yes. Wonderful father.
Darryl Williams.
Yes.
You know what? I just want to tell the listeners what a joy it is to interview this lady. We didn't even scratch the surface. I have pages of bio still here, Jack. What am I going to do with this stuff?
Well, you'll just have to stay alone afterwards and just keep going.
I'm just
going
to go to Starbucks on Lancashire and just read Ashley and Cole's bio.
Or Pete's Coffee.
Pete's Coffee. But
I have to shout out.
When is your next show coming up?
I'm going to be in Tucson, Arizona with Sheila E.
Ooh.
I am working on a Yoshi's Oakland show. I don't have a date yet. And I am going to be on the Dave Koz cruise. And that's about what I have right now. I'm doing some work. Check ashlingcole.com. All the dates will be on.
Another shout out to Robert and Elizabeth Garza, who are
taking
the train. And they love both these artists.
They are wonderful people.
And Robert was asking Elizabeth, how can we get the show on the train? And they should be watching on their phone now.
Oh,
as long as they have Wi-Fi.
Hey, guys.
But they wanted to give a shout out.
He also wants Daryl's blazer. You can't have that.
Wait. No.
And his shoes.
Robert has a collection.
I know.
His closet must just be.
Yes.
And her closet. Oh, my
goodness. I know.
Yes.
Aren't they gorgeous?
Yes. He is such a sharp guy. They both look so good together.
We want to hear you sing live.
Great. Let's do it.
Yeah. So let's give it to you.
This is a song that I wrote, a true story. This is actually my story about my last relationship. And I met him and I just was in love. He was just like so great and awesome. You can get the EP and hear about how he stomped on my heart after that. But in the meantime, this was about when we met and how I felt. Yeah.
Okay.
Ouch.
Tell the truth. Come on.
You heard it here first. Inside the music.
Great guy.
Okay, here we go.
Ouch.
This one I need a saxophone solo right now. Come on, guys.
Darryl could probably.
Adam Thies playing all these horn parts and arranging it. Shout out to Adam.
Wow.
Let me tell you the first time I saw my true love. He was standing there with a smile on his face, looking so fine. Boots, jeans, and a jacket with his hat turned to the side. There's something about this man, I said, 'cause butterflies are going wild. Sun is shining, birds are singing, and flowers in bloom. And all I keep thinking, baby, is what am I gonna do? I wanna give it to you, baby. I wanna give you kisses and real love. Every little thing you need, I wanna give it to you, baby. You're the one I want and all I need. So this is what I had to do. I had to walk on up and take a chance, not knowing if he had someone at home. Rather get let down easy than never have love at all. But to my surprise, he took my hand. He said, lady, may I have this dance? Oh my, say goodbye to all my lonely days. 'Cause the sun is shining, grass is greener, and flowers in. And all I keep thinking, baby, I'm so glad I get to give it to you, baby. I'm gonna give you kisses and real love. Every little thing you need, I'm gonna give it to you, baby. You're the one I want and all I need. So glad I finally found you. And every time you need me, I'm right and all I need. This is what I have to do, yeah. So glad.
Give it to you, baby.
Give it to you. There's a great trumpet solo, trombone solo, excuse me, Adam Thie, trombone. Gonna give it to you, gonna give it to you. Isn't that how we all feel, ladies? We see a man that's looking good and we just want to give him all we have. That's all we want to do. So good!
Wow, I don't even know what to say. I have goosebumps.
I like the grown folks calendar. The big people talk. Monday, big people talk.
Oh, is this on? Is this on? Is this microphone?
Big people
yeah,
talk.
It's on now, yeah.
Ashling Cole, grown folks calendar.
Oh, that's so funny.
And by the way, Ashling's a radio host herself.
Yes.
I am. Shout out to Freedom Radio and my Shop Talk family. Demetrius Toll Free is the station manager over there. Yeah, I do a gospel radio station every Thursday morning at 9 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. And it's great. And I'm working on another radio show, actually.
How can people tune in?
They can go to Freedom Radio, and it's a different spelling. It's F-R-E-E-D-E-M radio.com. And there's 24-hour gospel music happening all the time. You can go get the app for iPhone or Android. And, you can listen to music and tune into the show. It's live every Thursday morning at 9 a.m.
Such a pleasure. You are an amazing brand ambassador of Ashling Cole.
Thank
Biscuits
you.
Cole.
Thank you.
Biscuit.
Biscuits.
Biscuit.
I can't get over that.
Biscuit.
I don't even eat biscuits anymore. I don't.
I'm hungry.
I've gone vegan. How do you know someone's vegan?
Uh-oh.
Because they'll tell you.
Oh!
That's how you know.
Look out.
That's how you know.
Try the nachos. I'll be here all week.
That's exactly right.
So, absolutely amazing. Great performances and just looking forward to so much good
Thanks
stuff
so much
here.
For coming on. What a pleasure.
Now, I will say that I'm gonna throw this in before we move on to the amazing Fitzgerald over here.
That's right. That's a new name in 2018.
I also teach, and we didn't talk about this, and I have a series called Finding Your Voice, and it's really for people that sing, but maybe, you know, maybe they don't want to be professional singers, maybe they do, but it's for people to really get in touch with who they are as a person.
Great.
And it's about breath control and projection and how to be heard across a table or across a room. It's about confidence and all that. And so I'm taking new students. Yeah.
Can they click on your website?
You can go to ashlingcole.com and send me an email through my website.
Again, that's ashlingcole.com.
Yes, absolutely.
If there's a gentleman in a blue windbreaker with a tie-dyed scarf on your website going by the name of Kenny looking for a course, that's just you might want to vet him. Going by the name Kenny.
I'll go on there.
Come on, Jack. You can come hang out with me. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
You got it.
Kenny.
Where'd you go with Kenny?
This guy.
It's one of those nondescript. So we are, I was just so thrilled to do this show this week. When you have ultimate respect for your peers that are on the show, it just makes you want to really research them, respect them. I want to make sure that we take care of business because you guys are so content rich. By the time we just get through your teen years, it'll be 12.
Right.
So, Darryl, first, let's start off with, tell us about your website, your projects coming up, and just about how people can do just business and connect with you before we even start the good stuff. So
before we start the good stuff, the website is darrylfwalker.com, D-A-R-R-Y-L. F is for Fitzgerald.com. On Facebook, Instagram. That alone.
You're exhausted.
All those things. But there's a lot of good things happening in February. We have simultaneous releases, first of which will be the collaboration effort I'm doing with Keith Andrew, a Sonoma area guitar player and Billboard charting guitar player. it's funny. He saw me in an East Bay Soul show. We connected, and we've been doing appearances together. And
he's a cool guy.
And, oh, he's great.
He's a hard worker.
Yes.
What a work ethic.
Yes. And I like that. I resonate with people like that because that's how I am. I don't like people that have a lackadaisical attitude towards anything. It's like, let's get it done. Let's move on to the next
thing. I see you with Blake Aaron, too, and I just love that you guys are just...
He is an amazing human being. Talent beyond talent, and just his human being, period.
And a great radio show host in his own right, too.
Yes.
We have a funny history because we started in Arcadia in the early 90s, and he was in a band called Barbie and the Bad Boys. He had hair down to his waist, and I had a very lovely mullet and a headband and chest
yes,
hair and Cavarucci jeans.
I heard that look is coming back. I heard it's coming back.
Shirt. Oh, no.
And that's before I even go on stage. But like you, he still has one of the best hairlines in the business. So
he's got that hair.
Yes, he does. Well, you know what? I just always have been a fan of yours, and I love people like you that are just musical. Put them in a room, music will happen. A lot of artists now, they need semi trucks and lighting rigs and auto tuning, and then the show happens. You guys could pull up a campfire and just entertain, and I have so much respect for that. And
thank you, man.
I sincerely do, and I've seen you do that in action. But so you've got a cool bio too. You started singing at 2, and then right after that you joined the Army, and then you were at Boeing, and now you're
in the aerospace,
and you're at the Miramontes last week. I'm going to make a career out of really fixing my
You're good at truncating. I like yes. that. Let's get to the, okay, yes. What are the highlights here?
I love that, though, but seriously, though.
But he's an overnight a success, right?
Right. This guy burst on the scene out of nowhere.
See, what people don't know about you, which is just as important as your bio, we kind of knew in the business that this amazing dude, the saying, it's not rocket science, rocket science.
Yeah, he is rocket science.
He was a rocket scientist. But what's so funny is you were always doing that thing where probably watching the clock. I got Derek Bordeaux at 7 over at the White House. Can we get through this flow chart about propulsion?
Oh my God, that is exactly what my life was like for 23 years.
Let's see, I got the White House down in PCH, and this guy wants to talk about propulsion.
Oh, wait a minute. Will Donato called. I got to fill in for him because he's got to go on the road. Oh my God.
But it's really amazing the stuff that you got done when you were doing both.
It was insanity. Complete insanity. I look back now and I think, how in the hell did I pull that up? I was doing 60 hours a week on my aerospace thing. Wow. All the other time, vacation days, the 2-week break at the holiday time, and then sick days or whatever I could find to do this, to do live music.
And you
production.
Were doing quality. It wasn't like you were doing Bob and the Beer Gut Boys over at the Blues Bar.
I'm sure he had a gig like that. I'm sure. Oh. I'm sure.
But you were doing quality stuff too, to shift gears. And I know we have other spots in the bio to cover, but to me, I always was amazed by that, to be honest. And I never really confessed this, but I was juggling a day job when I started too. I was an urban planner. You try to not.
Really? I would never.
And I remember being at planning meetings thinking, I got a rehearsal with the Untouchables at West LA Music. Is the mayor ever going to shut up?
Wrap it up.
Well, I know you very well. You were an urban planner. Oh my God.
But you know what? Honestly, though, I enjoyed it. Developing and redevelopment and downtown improvement. And I know you liked your job too. So usually the cliche is, well, I hate being a telemarketer. I can't wait to be the world's greatest sax player or singer. But it's kind of weird when you don't mind your day job and it's satisfying. And then you're going, oh God.
It was for a long time.
It pays great.
No doubt. It was for a long time, but the last few years got to be really difficult because of the management part. When you ascend into that zone, then it's not as enjoyable because you're dealing with personalities. You're dealing with higher up people that have expectations.
You're not responsible for just you anymore.
No, and then the pressure of expectation, I'll just say that, is so great that it takes a physical toll on you. And it got to a point in 2010 where my health was suffering from all that I had been doing all those years and was doing at that time. So I had to make a decision. And I thought, okay, what will make me the happiest person I can be? Music. It was my mother who, on her deathbed, told me, I don't want you to do what I did. Wow. Promise me that you're going to honor your talent and honor who you really are. Don't, this woman that you're married to that's not helping you, don't do that. This work that you're doing is great, but it's not who you really want to be. So she said, I really hope that you will. I said, you don't have to say anymore. You don't have to say anymore. It's done.
You know what? I always watched you with respect, though. I knew that had to be hard because you didn't hate your job. I mean, I understand, like, management's always one episode away from Doonesbury. You know, it's just, there it is. Who ate the yogurt in the fridge? So, check this out. So I thought, man, and this guy is so damn good. He should be singing. And when I saw you make that move, and you still... I mean, I made my decision a long time ago because I wanted to play with Richard Marx, and I had a chance to be in a video when Dave Koz left. So I thought, I got to do this. So I went and filmed Angelia with Richard Marx with the mullet and the cowboy boots.
You had to do it.
And I just did it. And, I mean, that was a long... I was...
Easy decision to make, wasn't it?
It was. Yep. And I never... And I find myself... Like, just every adventure you're on, when you're on a bus with even, you know, East Bay Soul, like, I wouldn't be here if I was still looking at a flow chart for a propulsion template.
It's the truth. You and literally have to say to yourself, what do you really want to do?
You wouldn't be here right now if you sort of didn't propel yourself. And, like, this lovely lady, because you guys are so freaking versatile. Who's going to say no to Larry Graham? Oh, I want to do my Ashling Biscuit career. This pesky guy keeps calling me to do gigs with him at the Madison Square Gardens. I don't have time for that.
I don't have time for him. I'm doing my thing.
And it's like, you know, the decisions you guys have to make to just have that trajectory of a solo career. You know, it's just, but I just watched you with that corner of my eye with respect, thinking, I know he's a great engineer and I know he's a great singer. Man, that guy. But your mom was prophetic. She said,
It's the thing that opened my eyes the most, because you know you know these things internally, you really do, but you have a tendency of ignoring them because you're focused on what you have to. I have to do this. I have to be there. I have to be there. I have to do this. So your life just starts going, and before you know it, you're not paying attention to the inner voice, and you're just in this thing, and you're wondering, how the hell did I get here? You know. Then it's time for you to step back and assess things and go, okay, what's important? What are the main things I should be worried about right now?
Sometimes it takes somebody else to point that out.
It does. Yeah. It's someone you respect, someone you love, someone who you can be yourself with, who you have no walls up. You have, you know, it's just an open
thing.
When
you're doing that 8 to 5, it takes a lot of energy. You might get up at 6:30 in the morning. You don't get home till 6 at night. It doesn't a lot. It doesn't leave a lot for thinking about what moves your soul, right? It doesn't
give you, yeah. And for me, I was getting up at 4 in the morning.
Wow.
Now imagine me being on stage in, say, Orange County the night before.
Oh, dear God.
At this time, I was...
Were you doing East Bay Soul at that time?
Not until 2009. That's when I started with
that. She was working. You were working. I mean... You were the guy. You and Steve Nieves are the guys. You're the double threat.
Steve
Nieves is he's so freaking humble. Well, he's an
amazing person.
Because we can't go till, I don't know if you guys, can you stay till 6 tonight?
Oh, we can be here till end of the week.
Do you guys like fajitas?
Okay.
We're going to call in for
Are they vegan?
So.
She just told you.
She just told you.
Just told you.
So now. The Army, was that one of those things, I don't know what to do with my life, or was your dad military?
The family, pretty much. There were four people in the family, my grandfather and three uncles, who were in the military. And it was interesting you bring that up. It was more about wanting to be a man, wanting to take charge of my life, take charge of myself, that got that going.
Yeah.
There was a recruiter on the high school campus, wasn't in your face, wasn't making false promises or anything. He was just this guy that said, what are you going to be doing when you get out of here? You know, he put a question in my head, and I went, well, shit, you know, I haven't really thought about that. I'm in the band. I'm in Andrew Carney's band. You know, Andrew Carney and I grew up together, and we're playing music together, and the marching band, and I'm doing this, I'm doing that. Have a little job I'm working. I'm thinking, life is good. Well, no, we need to get serious. So that guy planted, I believe his name was Sergeant Pap. Wow. He planted an idea in my head, and I went, I still don't know who Darryl Walker is. I really don't. I mean, I know the music thing. I know my little circle here in California, my friends. but who am I really? And it took that for me to figure out.
I don't think most people at that age even think about that.
They don't really. Yeah, yeah. And it's because I was the oldest kid that I had that responsibility nature. So at I was 17. Wow. I took the test, went in, they swore me in. And then after I graduated as a senior, I went right in literally 4 weeks after graduation and I was gone.
It's really interesting what informs your point of view, though, because a lot of people at that juncture, if you know, you had that innate singing talent and the saxophone, and you could have gone to Northridge or North Texas State or Berkeley and been that guy. Mm-hmm. You could have been, you know, just Cal State Fullerton, who am I guy. Mm-hmm. It's funny though. So were you playing sax in high school or mm-hmm. singing
junior
too?
Junior high and high.
Were you doing the double threat thing already?
Yeah, that started long. But the funny thing was, I became known as a horn player way before anybody knew I could sing. I thought singing was something that everyone could do. I literally, I'm serious. When I was a kid, it was something I took for granted. Like, oh yeah, okay, we're all gonna sing Happy Birthday, la la la. And then I thought, well, everyone can do this. It wasn't until I got to be, I say, maybe 14 or 15 that I realized, wait a minute, this is a little something different here. Let's develop this, you know? Because my mom was an amazing vocalist. I got most of my inspiration came from her because she sang like you wouldn't even believe. I mean, I can't even.
So who's the first person to recognize your ability?
She was.
Yeah.
Yeah. She always encouraged it. See, and that's the thing. She would. If she wasn't at a performance with her friends, egging me on and, you know, being the cheerleader.
Did you sing with her at all?
Only at home.
Yeah.
And just, like I said, I took it for granted. Just something we all did, you know, holiday time, whatever, someone's birthday, whatever. Or just fooling around, you know, just something's on the radio and we're singing with it. You don't realize what's really happening in the background is you're being conditioned thought-wise and through your technical ability to be able to do that thing. You don't even realize it's happening at that
Were there
point.
Opportunities to sing in high school?
No, because no one knew I did. You know, it was something I just did that most people didn't even know about.
What was your first, let's just say, first gig? And even the, you know, like the 14, 15-year-old, where you're like, hey, this is something here.
It was with Andrew Carney's band. Oh. Yeah, he had a fusion jazz band, and we did.
Andrew Carney's a local
trumpet player. Yes,
yeah. From this area.
Uh huh.
And Lakewood, do you remember that? Do you remember the feel of the night and the, just the sounds and the?
It was amazing. It was the thing that made me want to do this because seeing the audience react to what we were doing that we, you know, again, we took for granted because we hang out and we play all the time, we rehearse or whatever, but when you do it for someone or a bunch of people. It's a whole different energy that takes place. Yeah. If you're committed to it and if you're really doing it from your heart, there's an energy exchange that takes place. And that's what has me so transfixed on doing this. It's just touching people and then feeling the appreciation come back. It's just, you don't need drugs, you don't need booze, you need that. That's the kind of energy I like.
And then I want to play one cut off your EP right now so people can hear a little bit of Darryl Walker. So Be There For You. Can you tell us about that?
That is a song that I co-wrote with a wonderful musician by the name of Ron Bolton. He's a San Diego person. He does TV music, bumper stuff for all kinds of different programs. But he also was in the corporate world corporate musician for a lot of years. And he's just one of those guys that's an amazing person in the studio because he plays the guitar, plays the keyboard. He's a great lyricist. And he's a good engineer. And we just started bouncing ideas around and we sat down and started, he came up with this track. I'm more of a collaborator than I am on my own. I really love working with other people because they pull things out of me that I wouldn't know were there or that I wouldn't think about. Yeah. It's funny how, I can sit down and conceive something obviously, but seeing it come to fruition and seeing it be the best it can be is when I'm working with other people.
You're not gonna sing 7-part harmony in GarageBand to
I could do that. I mean, I did it on this
song idea out there.
I did it on this EP, but nice. Not in that fashion. I had a person, you know, nice. Kevin Flournoy, helping me to put it all together.
Yay, Kevin!
But it's just collaboration
and
to me.
And then
is the thing.
What made you decide to do your own EP?
Pressure from other people.
That was 2013, right?
Mm-hmm. Pressure from other people. because I'd done the Motown Records thing, I'd done the Taboo Records thing, the A&M Records thing, the blah, blah, blah.
Can we digress right there? Because that's pretty significant. Boeing, Army. So somewhere in this sandwich of excellence, there is a record deal. I got an 8 record deal with A&M. I was at boot camp, and I had a night off with with Tom Cruise and
ran down to.
Wow. When? Where? Was 2010? No, 2000s, right?
Actually, 92.
Because A&M was sexy good.
Oh man,
that was that must have been exciting.
So exciting. They had
Tony Charles. Tony Charles was on.
Oh yeah. Oh.
I did a song with Tony Charles in that era.
Oh.
House of Hope album.
Great stuff. Great stuff.
So you did, you got an 8 album deal at A&M.
Well,
for you or a project?
Well, it was a project formulated by Chris Troy of Van Nuys and Zach Harmon, who's now no longer in LA, but he's in Texas. They formed a group called Identity Crisis. That's how I met Salo Loyo, who co-wrote Hold Me, the song Hold Me on the EP that he's about to play.
He's a really great guy. Salo Loyo.
He's insane funny. But, you know, these collaboration things, again, it's all about meeting people and networking and then finding out who you resonate with and just working with them. And it's amazing what can happen.
Was there, on that period of time, though, that it moved to Motown for a minute, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have those records of that? There was one record that came out of that, right?
Yes.
I thought I had heard it from Salo. Do you have that record still somewhere?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Mm-hmm. It was a good record, I thought.
It was an amazing record. There were some great songs on there. On my website, there's, is it my website or SoundCloud? Might be SoundCloud. There's one called I've Got What You Need, and it's a ballad that's just...
I remember hearing that, and I
Christopher
thought,
wow. Troy and Zach Harmon put a wonderful song together, and that's a defining moment.
You were at, you were still doing aerospace then too.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. Wow, it's almost impossible.
So I can't ask you the cliche question. So did you have heartbreak after that deal fell apart? Nope, I was at work at 9 o'clock the next day. I had a staff meeting at 10.
The truth is, I was laid off when that was going on. I hadn't made the jump into management yet, so I was one of the people on the line doing hydraulics and all these different crazy things that have to do with aircraft production. But I was out of work and focused solely on that.
Yeah.
But then when that
it was like a trial run for 2010, kind of.
Pretty much. Okay. Do you really want to do this?
I can sleep in a little bit. Have one extra Mai Tai.
So for our audience, if you need city planning or aerospace, call LA Talk Radio.
Or a cocktail waitress.
Or a cocktail.
It's a triple threat. Wow. Oh, that's so funny. But God, I was so excited for you when I saw that you were just full time. And I just thought, gosh, this guy's, it's so hard to do both and just... You can only have so much energy.
Exactly.
And you're the front man-ish on most of your projects, even if there's a guy there. Yeah.
Okay, well, let's hear the fruits of his labor right here. Be there for
the
you.
Segway master.
Yeah. I love it. I love it.
Here we go.
I want to hold you, girl, all through.
It's beautiful, dude.
Thank you. Segway master.
Segway. You take your time. You don't rush anything, man.
No, you know, it's funny. Just sitting here listening to that again, it catapulted me back to the actual recording of all that. Mm. And, man, those things that were going on then, it was everything for me that's going on in my life affects what I do, either positively or negatively, but as performers, you could always draw from that, and I think you kind of touched on that earlier.
Absolutely.
It's
this draws fuel. You back to that time.
It's fuel. Yeah. It's fuel for your creativity.
Like I have a song on the EP called What Do You Do, and it's about what do you do when you love somebody and they don't love you back.
What a passionate song.
I haven't been in that situation. It's coming on 5 years. Like, I've been out of that situation. Every time I sing it, it's as if it happened last night.
Wow. It's hard to sing those songs at your show sometimes when you're so emotionally connected to them. I have a song I wrote for my mom who died of Alzheimer's, and it's called Do You Remember Me?
Oh. Yeah.
The first time they don't know your name, and I literally can't
do it. That's crushing. Yeah, that's crushing.
Yeah. You guys ready to party?
No, it's therapy.
Yeah.
But you know, but what's so beautiful, I'm so glad that you said that, because the audience wants that from
authenticity.
You. They want to have that authenticity and have that connection with you. And when you let that wall down and you invite your audience in to have that experience with you, it's healing for them as much as it is for you. I mean, it's therapeutic.
Well, I didn't really talk about this with you guys, but I love when I see, you know, Rolls Royces and BMW sitting here, and I'm very conscious of song selection in my shows, and I actually write albums just to populate my show set. Something needs replacing. Mm. I'm gonna write a song, make something authentic, but it does have to take a spot in my set list. Mm-hmm. Otherwise I'll be playing, you know, I'll Be Around for 50 years. And this all came from a conversation hearing Tony Bennett go, man, I'm 80 and I'm just finally got my show set list together. All right, Pachanga tomorrow. That's funny, though, because you guys, it's all on your perspective. You're as timeless as your heart is.
Absolutely.
And in the genre we're in, there's always a... My idol is Sanborn, and right now he's getting on a plane, and he's 72. Yeah. But anyway, back to... I'm fascinated when I see artists perform like you. In your shows, you've got EPs out. How much are you putting in of your original music? How much do you still rely on some cover just to keep the energy of the show? And that feeling when you sit down by yourself after a show like this and you go to Starbucks, let's see what that Italian dude's talking about. And you write 10 songs and you go, that one, I need something. And then you go home and you go, I'm going to make my own version of a Mariah song that inspires me. Mm. And you draw, I find that process fascinating, and it drives my creativity, populating a set list.
I'm glad you brought that up.
Because we're all going to do shows soon. Yeah. And shame on us if we don't keep it. It's not about keeping it fresh, because Tower still has to do what is hip.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But you still want
to
do...
Thank God they have to
still... Well, you guys so deserve the best song selections in your shows, and sometimes only we know when we sit down.
His band does what is hip, right? East Bay Soul, don't they do it?
We don't do any Tower stuff in Greg's show.
What is hip,
No, there's a couple of occasions where we did, but it was a guest artist that came in and did it with us.
Right.
Like, yeah. I didn't mean to divert that, but I'm so fascinated because we all will be doing a show in X weeks. We all have 10, maybe 11 songs to do our contracted 90. And I'm just fascinated on how I always strive to populate my set list. Mm. And it's really important to me to make sure.
It's a big deal.
Especially with YouTube now. You know, it's like, I saw that song. I'm like, oh, God.
Well, if I may, when we do our show in Yoshi's, and I did it last year when in Yoshi's in Oakland, and it's called, you know, Finding Your Voice. So it actually talks about auditioning for the San Francisco Girls Chorus. I sing Oh Danny Boy, which is what I use to audition, right? So then, and then I take
them
into...
Can you give us a little...
Oh Danny Boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. It's I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so.
Can we get a couple
tap.
Guinness over here? A couple Guinness and a harp?
On tap.
Just once again.
That's artistry on
artistry.
Tap.
Hello.
But I chose to do my show in a timeline. And you know, and I end it with...
Wow, that's great. I love that.
It's a purposeful show set.
That's great.
So you show how you evolved as an artist.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Yeah.
You know, it's funny because a lot of us are getting thrown in packages, and I find it funny that
sometimes... That drives me nuts.
Well, you know, it's like, jump! Yeah. High
yeah.
energy!
Yeah.
Well, this lady just told a story where she's going to start with Danny Boy to tell where her authenticity comes from. I like to start intimate. I actually end intimate now. Mm. I mean, you know, I did a whole cancer
battle.
Nothing
wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that.
And I like, as an artist, when you get to your own arc of your show, it's just so special, and it takes a lot of...
He's whoever's listening that's a musician, he's giving you the keys to the kingdom, because mm-hmm. the word arc has been used a few times, and it really is important to set up your show so that it has a starting point, a yeah. crescent, you know, yes. a peak, and then on another side that goes down after that, but not down in a low energy way, but energy-wise in terms of... You're boom, 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 boom. Yeah. yeah, let's party. Let's do this.
The
and all of a sudden, you need to get real intimate.
Well, unless you're Lionel Richie, where every single song is a hit.
Exactly.
And so it's on 12, every single song is a hit.
My friend Nick Colione, I opened up for him, and I've got my little.
He's great. Yeah.
Boom, boom, right. boom. I turned to my buddy, somebody call 911. Yes. This is going to be a heart attack here.
Yes. Massacre. Yes.
But anyway.
Shout out to Nick Colione and Garrett Body.
Yes.
Out in Chicago where it's 8 degrees.
God
We're
bless
so
them.
Sorry. We're
awesome
so sorry.
Artists. But you mentioned about covers. You know, when it comes to cover stuff, for me anyway, as an artist, I kind of take the Luther Vandross approach to that. And he once said in one of his interviews, it was a concert video that he released, but there were several sections where they were talking to him about stuff like this. And he said that he takes a song that moves him and makes it his own.
Yeah. I love that.
And that's the key. You're not just doing another song that was already released. If you don't make it your own, and I'm not saying by taking the kind of liberties that make the song obscure and not recognizable, but making it your own, meaning that you're coming from your soul with your intent and your storytelling, as you said earlier, storytelling ability, that is owning the song and doing the song. I take covers as seriously as I do my own stuff because I want to put my best work out. I don't want, it's like, for instance, you mentioned the year that I released the EP. That was a while ago, but I don't do things so fast that they're just out there to be out there. I want the best thing I can do out. So if it takes me a few years, especially when I'm financing all my own stuff, which I do, which is, but you have to release work you're proud of, in my opinion.
And you know what's too is, again, when you control the arc of your show, you can respectfully set it up as a tribute. I don't always do it, but sometimes I say, you know, I'm a son of Grover and Sanborn.
Oh, yeah,
and then you'll play, you know, something hopefully a little obscure. But I find that really lovely to, you know, like for you, again, I want to go back one second. After hearing that song, I'm adding more influences that I'm hearing from. You're like the C's candy of hit male vocalists.
You know, well, speaking of
Marvin Gaye, Luther, Bobby.
Speaking of tribute, you do a show, an Al Jarreau show, something you started, what, in the last year, maybe?
It's been, in about a year.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So why don't you tell us about that?
Well, it's funny because all the things we've been talking about influence the decision to do that. You know, when I was in Germany in the military, the one artist I listened to a lot was Al Jarreau. I mean, as a kid, I had listened to him and not known who he was. My mom exposed me to him. But as a young adult, I was listening to him because of his, you mentioned technicians, his precision.
Oh, man.
And but see, he had not just precision, he had this innate thing of being so musical and able to touch people that didn't even like jazz. He was touched, that's why he was the kind of artist that got the Grammys
crossover,
across the board.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he...
Crossover, vocalese.
But I started doing that, listening to him, and then I said, you know what, I could do all that stuff. Why don't I just do this? And so I put together a show in my head first of my favorite Al Jarreau songs. What would I do if I took this somewhere? Which songs would I choose? How would I stage it? How would I do it as a production?
Don't you have a large band for that?
11 people. Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Oh my gosh.
Are any of your East Bay Soul guys in that or no?
It's called West Bay Soul.
Yeah.
It's a lot of...
It's people that are in my solo act band, which goes from 5 to 7 pieces depending on who's in town and what money's available. But the 11-piece concept came as a, I guess it was my desire to effectively and realistically represent the music. You can't do Algero music with two people or three people or four people. I mean, you could probably do some straight ahead stuff and be very minimalistic, but to do the songs that people know,
I love that,
the way they need to be done, you have to concept. To stage it with a full band. It's just no other background singers, at least three, horns, at least three, and then the other members of the group.
You know, the thing about you guys, though, I like your comment about, I thought everybody could sing. Trust me, when you're about 16 and realize your voice only goes so high and it stops, you're like, oh, well, that's so much for that dream.
Okay.
But, you know, there's an element, too, that you guys should be aware of, too. Sometimes with your versatility, we just want to hear an hour's worth of Ashling. There's some of us that are selfish. We want to hear all Darryl for an hour. So that in awesome. Your humility.
Thank you.
I had a conversation with a friend of mine, and we had Jay Gore on here one night, and he said,
Jay. He's crazy. I love
I
him.
Love so Jay Gore.
Dave Koz took him out to lunch and said, how come you don't have an album out? And Jay goes,
oh.
No, and he didn't mean it. And because he was so busy being everybody's sideman.
No, I mean, but that's the kind of thing. It takes that defining moment. Someone to say, someone you respect to say,
absolutely.
Hey, why aren't you
absolutely.
Doing that? Oh, you can't answer. Mm-hmm.
There's a saxophone player locally. I won't name his name, but he is the sax player to everybody. And he's now accepted himself. He goes, oh, no, I just like to be 10 degrees back. And I'm thinking, you know what? That's pretty selfish. I think so. Because I want to hear an album of him. But he's so, I'm not going to say beat down, but he's just so used to, you know, if it's Friday, I'm playing with so-and-so, and he's killing, and he's so beautiful to hear. And I'm tired of, like, to hear him, I got to grab, you know, this guy's album, it's cut 7. Okay, I'm on this one.
Yeah.
You know, like,
it's
you
a
know.
Whole. It's probably a whole nother hour, but 20 Feet from Stardom, which was an amazing documentary that was out a couple years ago
I
about background
that.
Singers, mm-hmm. I cried the whole time, like from
I
beginning to
it.
End, because I was like, they are telling our story. Some people are just not cut out to be in the front.
No, and I understand
that. And that, you know what I mean? And it's like some people are, and then there's others of us, like myself, that's just content to be in the background and supporting other artists. I love being able to make somebody else, you know, support them and all that stuff. But
no,
sometimes.
Understand that.
When Dave Koz says to you, you should do a solo record,
well,
or Prince,
every
or
time
whoever,
I see,
you know what I mean?
Every time I see
exactly.
Darryl booked at Spaghettini's, I go, you did it, dude.
Oh,
yeah. You got
thank
following.
You.
Yes.
You're filling out little squares. You got those non-view tables, yeah. one left.
Oh,
and you got people that are coming to see you. Yes. Darryl, I swear, he did it. He's there.
That's the one that's the toughest.
I know.
To get
you know, a compliment to both
but
of you guys.
I'm just saying that because, you know, I every time I see you, when I saw you at Miramontes, I go,
yeah.
That's so cool.
You know, what, Darryl, compliment to you and Will as well. You guys kill Spaghettini. You're one
Thank
of the
you.
Few people that come back, and sell out every time. It's very impressive, both of you.
It speaks to the people that want to see what we do.
Yeah.
I mean, without them, you can't do this.
Yeah, and I
Just
hope you
it.
Keep doing that Al Jarreau show. By
I
the
have
way, I wanted
two
to,
of those
I wanted to Great. Ask you... can you give us a little sample? I know we didn't bring music or anything, not to put pressure on you. You want to do a little
a
cappella?
Pressure.
Al Jarreau.
Can you do Al Jarreau doing Brick House?
Oh!
Hot chili.
Oh, she's up.
Yeah!
Brick
House.
Yes!
That's it.
She's up. Brick House.
Yes.
From your, what do you do in your show? Give us a little sample of that.
In my show, it's a 20 song,
do
90
your favorite,
minute show.
Do your favorite.
Yeah, 20, right through.
Wow,
bam.
I'm
God
there. I'm going to put my name on one of those tables.
It's ridiculous. we do, let's see, what's my favorite one?
It's like a diamond ring.
Yeah, I mean, it is. Shoot. How about.
Do you
gotta
do
have fun. You gotta have fun. You gotta have fun. You got to have fun. The wonderful things that you get out of life, there are four. You know, the old Miles Davis. I mean, this is.
I love his jazz crossover. So when you're in that mode, 4 days before a show, you do the show, the band's there, everyone's on time. So now it's Tuesday after the weekend show. Do you have a minute to shake off the Al Jarreauisms when you're
woo? Well,
do you
the funny
to be
thing
Darryl
is,
again?
I try really hard to, I want to pay tribute and honor that music, but I don't try to be him. I do my thing.
Oh, that's so cool.
But I don't change the stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's authentic. The arrangements are authentic to what he did.
Yeah.
The scat solos are verbatim.
Really?
You do
the scats?
Yeah, I do the scat solos like on Sophisticated, well, not that one. I do Sophisticated Lady. But there's scat solos like on Spain. We do Spain.
Ooh,
we do
Spain too?
Oh, yeah.
Can we hear a little scat solo, a little short one?
Let's see. You're making me jump into a song here. Let's see. let's see. I have to get in the right place. Then we get into this. You know, and then you just...
That is so unbelievable.
Now, we don't do it that fast, but those are pretty much the notes that he's singing.
For people out there, look for his Al Jarreau tribute show, real treat.
It's
called treat.
Darryl F. Walker Sings Al Jarreau.
Nice.
Yes.
And I do this because that music needs to be kept alive. And that
absolutely.
Music influenced me.
And you do
tremendously.
It so good.
Tremendous.
You really
Thank
do.
You.
Thank yeah.
you.
Absolutely.
That's such a respectful brand extension because it's just, you know, now that he's gone, like you said, you carry that flame of that artist. And the affectations that he has are something every singer would love to have in their toolkit.
Unbelievable what
it's
he can get out of his voice. You know what he got? He was able to be an instrument. He was able to be a vocalist. He just sings. He was able to. The range of ability is just unbelievable.
Mm. He was an amazing storyteller too. I met him in San Francisco. We used to. I was 13, 14 years old. You know, my fake ID getting me in the club on Hate Street. Yeah, but I had a circle of friends that knew Al, and we used to sit around. He just poured into this little wide-eyed little girl and just about life and all that stuff. I'm so glad that you're doing that tribute.
Oh, and there's another inspiring person. For all of us, he was. Mid-70s, still getting it done.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The work ethic of these guys.
Shout out to Chris Walker. No relation, I don't think, but Chris Walker was Al Jarreau's music director.
And he's on the Dave Cause Cruise.
Phenomenal. Yes, he's a keeper on the Dave Cause Cruise. Absolutely.
So, Darryl, you're going to sing live here in a minute, but I want to hear how you met Greg Adams and got the East Bay Soul gig.
Funny story. I was literally standing outside in Del Mar looking down the street, I was thinking about what was life, which turn life was taking, because I was making the decision to end my aerospace days and become strictly a musician. And it's really ironic that phone call came on that day. My phone was in my pocket, my cell phone, and it rang while I'm standing out there going, what the hell am I going to do next?
That's after your mom said, follow your heart?
Absolutely. Well, she said that 3 years prior, before she died. And I remember that, and I still hold it dear. But the call came in, and it was just an invitation to record some songs first. He said, well, we've got four singers on the thing, and just wanted to tell you that first of all. And when he first called, I didn't believe it was him. I'm like, yeah, right, Greg.
So this is legendary trumpeter Greg Adams from Tower of Power.
The quintessential arranger of the songs.
Yeah. Then he calls again. No, really, seriously. I need to talk to you. I want to. Okay, go ahead. What's going on? And he goes, well, your name came up in Sean Holt, which is a dear friend of mine. Shout out to Sean, if you're listening, if you're watching.
He's not at Boeing right now, is he?
He is a professor at USC and an amazing musician singer himself. But it was he who put my name on the long list at the bottom alphabetically of singers that Greg was listening to audition for this project, East Bay Soul. It started with Lenny Williams.
Wow.
That didn't work out. Then Phil Perry. That didn't work out. And then he had to go through this list. And he gave up midway. Left the room, and his wife Andrea kept listening and going, Greg, called him back.
Wow.
And apparently I had there was a reference to a website that I was on, featured on a friend's song, Doug Ross, great bass player who's now in Maryland. and they listened to that and contacted me, and he said, oh, we're doing this record, but you know, I just got to tell you, we have four other singers. I said, what? Four singers? Like, oh, okay, well. And the reason was because of those previous situations that didn't work out. He didn't want to be held hostage by any one person, because his idea was to write an album that was focused on vocals, and the instrumental stuff would be a secondary.
I can't picture that band now without you. I really cannot.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, you
and Kaytar too.
Oh my goodness.
Oh,
don't even get me started.
Is he awesome?
We can do 2 hours just on that.
I met Kaytar through this nice man right here.
Yeah. So I said yes. You know, and the rest is history. I've been with them now almost 10 years.
Such a perfect fit.
And it just works. It's a beautiful thing. The level of talent in that band is ridiculous. And the people, I remember just sending them all a Christmas note, thanking them for who they are and how they contribute, not only to that project, but to my life. Because these people are amazing human beings. They're not just talented people. They're just really great people.
I love that project. You know, its tower was just so iconic. They just needed it to be another.
This band is great. They really
take
are.
On that concept and
he's
Greg
killing
is,
it.
Greg's arrangements. Does Greg arrange everything in the band, or occasionally will Greg or somebody else avail or somebody do it, or is it pretty much? I mean, in a good way, does Greg just lay the template on the horn arrangements?
He does all the horn arrangements. Now, influences come from several people in the band. He writes with Nick Milo primarily. Who is also our keyboard player and formerly
Nick.
The musical director for Joe.
And he had an amazing mullet in the day, too.
He did. when he was a Tower Power.
Wow.
He did.
They all had the Daniel Day-Lewis,
yes,
too.
Yes.
They all did.
And Greg jokes about, you know, this band is made up of Tower Power alumni, because it pretty much is. You have Herman Matthews on drums, Lee Thornburg, when he's not off with Joe Bonamassa or whoever he works with, he's with us. Nick Milo, of course, was a bandmate. In Tower Power.
That's enough there. That's enough there to drive
three.
A bus.
And then Johnny Bamont, who's with Huey Lewis on baritone, alto, and tenor.
He's
and
so food. Awesome. That guy is such a... He's a Swiss Army knife.
Yeah, he is, right? He and Greg Veil cracked me up because they both travel with like a whole van full of instruments. You know, they show up... setting up. Okay, there's a flute. There's a this. There's a that. Soprano, alto, tenor, baritone. It's like, good Lord.
And they're all good. And Greg Veil is good on every dang one of them.
Everyone. He inspires me nightly.
I'm a Greg Veil fan.
Okay, guys, it's time for Darryl to play live. Then after that, you guys are going to give us a little surprise. We don't know what it is.
We don't either.
Yeah.
Hey. Nobody knows.
Okay.
No pressure, Jack.
Okay, so you want to set up
where it lands.
See
there
you
go.
Through it all for us. You want to
sure.
set that up?
Let's set that up. Of all the songs, I have two favorites on the EP. The one that I wrote with Salo Loyal, Hold Me, is my definitive favorite song because it's the best song I've ever written, hands down. It resonates with me very well. This one is a treat because I did this as a demo with Kevin Flournoy. It's his tune. And it was for Kenny Loggins. And when his camp didn't pick it up, I looked at him and I said, hey, what you going to do with that tune?
I like I like the Jack Black eyebrows there.
EP, right. You know. And Kevin said, okay, no problem. So we put it on the EP. But this song is an amazing thing.
It is, yeah.
When he brought it to me, I went, oh, wow, that's beautiful. I'd like to do that. And then I really listened to it, and went, oh, shit, I have to do that. Because it takes you through different, as a singer, you'll appreciate the different modalities where your full voice, your half voice, your falsetto, your all these things have to interconnect in this song to make it work the way it does.
Okay, let's do it.
It's crazy. If there was a way from the start for me to know how much I love you, maybe I could have played a better part and made it plain to see just what we'd
If I can do it all again, throw my conscience to the wind for your love, just to keep the fire burning, hoping this time will never end. Rest assured, if you ever fall, I will be there for you. I will see you through it all. Ooh. La da da da. I look into your eyes and there I see what's in your heart. The things we hope for, can we ever know our destiny? Will our fate be love, or could there be more? Yes, I will. Throw my conscience to the wind for your love, just to keep the fire burning, hoping this time will never end. Rest assured, if you ever fall, I will be there for you. I will see you through. And we'll go all the way straight to the stars. And it come what may, this love will be ours. Just a love, all our love. Yes, I would do. Throw my conscience to the wind for your love, just to keep the fire burning, hoping this time will never end. Rest assured, if you ever fall, I will be there for you. I will see you through. I'll see you through it all. See you through it all. See you through it all.
Okay, so we are basically out of time, but we're gonna do a little thing between you guys. And how can people get your EP? It's called Hold Me, isn't it?
Beautiful. Yes.
Yeah.
On the website, DarrylFWalker.com. There's a page, music store, and you just go there. And
please get it. Every song is spectacular.
Same
with Ashling.
What was the website of the Ashling Cole Vocal Academy again?
Yes, absolutely.
It's the ABC.
It's funny that you say that, because that is my long-term goal, to have a music school and have people come in and be able to learn how to play instruments.
You'll
and learn your business and learn how to take care of your health and learn how to all of that stuff. Yes.
And it's the ABC Academy.
So
yeah, there you go.
What,
Ashling?
Exactly.
You guys,
exactly.
Thanks so much. Why don't you guys take us home?
Do you know if loving you is wrong?
Oh Lord. You know, I always play on that. I don't sing it.
Oh, I was gonna sing doom. Doo doom doo doom.
So she's singing bass.
Come on. What, just start singing something. Sing anything. You can sing
It's like a diamond ring, it's a precious thing.
Yay.
And we never wanna lose it.
Never wanna lose it.
It is like a favorite song that you love to sing.
Loving.
Every time we hear the music, doo-doo-doo. We're in this love together. We got the kind that will last forever.
Forever, yeah.
Yeah, doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo.
We're in this love together.
And like berries on the vine, it gets sweeter all the time.
Yeah.
Time. Time.
Thank you for joining us, today. Two stunning brand ambassadors.
Aww. I like that. Thank you, Will.
And
thank you,
Joel.
Thank you all so much.
Masters.
And for our audience, we're here normally the first and third Saturday of every month. We're going to make an exception this month because of the NAMM show. We're going to have a NAMM show here on 127 on January 27th. Our guests are Selena Albright, another vocalist.
Fantastic.
And Justin Young, a sax player.
Great.
Yeah. Right. So tune
I wanna
in.
I want to come back. Have me let's come back and do this again.
Yeah. We haven't even scratched the surface.
Yeah. We have two more pages to get through. What is this? We need two more.
We haven't even graduated high school yet.
I know.
Again, I love the show. I just love
thank you guys
being here and listening to both you guys. It was
thank you.
Such a great experience.
Thanks, Jeff.
Anyway, everybody, have a safe weekend and.
Here,
thanks so much, everybody around the world, for tuning in.
Guys, you killed it. Favorite show so far, Jack?
It's Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.